What is up, ladies and gentlemen? It is Monday night, which means I'm coming to you live with another edition of MBR, Nothing But Rants, the show where I find topics that I'm rather passionate about and I pontificate upon them. These are not hot takes, but rather takes that I am hot about. We got a loaded show for you tonight, as we typically do, and we'll start it off, as we always do, with our opening kick brought to you by Cola Kicks. And it's about how player free agency has pretty much made its way into college football. And you better buckle up, okay? This isn't anything new, but I thought Kirby Smart hit on something perfect today in his press conference. And it, you know, had things spinning in my brain in terms of what it means when player mobility arrives upon the shores of your sport, right? I think to me, and this will be no coincidence for those of you who know me, for me, player mobility and the king of player mobility, if you will, the creator of player mobility in terms of the modern athlete, is LeBron James. Okay, LeBron James is the first athlete in our lifetime that has pretty much controlled and dictated every move of his career, right? He's decided how things are going to go. He's decided the teams that he's going to play for and the contract links that he's going to have, right? And so LeBron does that. Next thing you know, that's what the NBA is about, right? NBA is about super teams, free agency, player mobility, players having the ability to pretty much put their own teams together, right? Super teams were now a thing in the NBA. And as the years go on, right, we think, oh, these kind of things, they'll never make their way to football, right? It'll never lap upon the shores of football, professional or college, right? Wrong. Now we're starting to see NFL quarterbacks, right? NFL quarterbacks go out as far as, you know, requesting trade demands, right? Russell Wilson this past offseason saying, I'll be traded to Chicago, New Orleans, you know, gives a list of teams. I believe the Las Vegas Raiders were one of those teams, right? Gives a list of teams that he would ultimately be willing to be traded to and then backs off those things, right? We had Aaron Rodgers threaten to hold out the entire offseason, was holding out the entire offseason. He's now back in Green Bay, likely his last season, right? So we've seen player mobility creep its way into other sports in American, you know, sportdom. I don't think sportdom's a word, but you get it. You've been a member of this broadcast long enough to know that I make up words occasionally. But player mobility has made its way into these other avenues of sports, and it's changed them. Some would say for the better. Some would say for the worst. I'm not here to debate those things, right? I'm just here to forewarn you that this is making its way into college football as well via the NCAA transfer portal. It has. Okay, it's here now. So get ready for it and start accepting it, right? And I know we've been talking about the transfer portal for a really long time, right? A really long time we've been talking about this. But I think we're just now getting into the real impacts, right, of what it is that the NCAA transfer portal is going to do or likely going to do to college football, right? It's changing rosters ever so slightly every day, right? New people going into it, some people coming back out of it, right? Coaches scanning it for a potential, you know, patch or to fill a hole or a need on your roster, right? But I think Kirby said something today that I had never thought about. But you should. Because every time an NBA player reaches free agency or has the ability to decide where he wants to play, every time an NFL wide receiver has the, you know, freedom or mobility, like Odell Beckham, because he was cut and waived by the Browns, to decide where he wants to play, they choose one of two options. The option that helps you best win or the option with your best buddies, right? Both options, most of the time, lead to super teams. Right? They lead to what we're seeing out with the LA Rams, where you've got nothing but superstars on one roster. Von Miller, Jalen Ramsey, Aaron Donald, Matthew Stafford, Odell Beckham Jr. I mean, the list goes on and on and on of stars out there on that roster. You give player mobility and player freedom to NBA players, what do you get? You get the Brooklyn Nets. You get the LA Lakers. You get these teams. You get the Warriors, right? That ended up deciding all to stay together. You get my point. The moment player mobility reaches its, you know, makes its way into your favorite sport, you're going to see these things happen where teams band together and the rich get richer. Okay? Guess what? Georgia's going to pull the best player from West Virginia's roster almost every year moving forward. And it might not always be West Virginia, right? But it's going to be somebody. There's going to be a Tyke Smith every year. Now the new one's Elias Ricks. Last year it was Avery Gilbert, right? There's going to be one of these every single year. And guess what? They ain't going to Georgia Tech. They're probably going to end up at a program like Georgia or at a program like Alabama, right? That's how these things work. The rich get richer, super teams get created. And I think Kirby Smart hit the nail on the head today when he was talking about what the transfer portal is going to do to college football. Every time this happens, every time player mobility reaches its way into your sport, you get super teams. You get unbalanced equations when it comes to the share in the wealth of talent. That's nothing new to college football. I mean, the talent's been accumulated in minute portions and minute regions of the country for as long as college football has been around, basically. Started out at the beginning in the Northeast with all the smart schools, the Harvards, the Yales, the Armies, the Navies, right? And then it made its way down to the Southeast. It is what it is. We got some questions about Elias Ricks. Guys, we will address all of those over on Patreon. You guys know by now, we don't answer specific player-related questions. I'm sure Travis Hunter will get asked at some point tonight a question about him. We don't answer these things on public forums. We respect the privacy there. We do have some limited information what is available over on patreon.com/BrooksAustin. Before we get into tonight's show in terms of the rundown of what we got, I would like for you guys to like and thumbs up the video. Viewership is going to be down, I would imagine, for a couple of maybe weeks. We did have a show name change or a YouTube channel name change. Got away from just naming it myself and changed it to the Film Guy Network. So I think that's going to impact some numbers moving forward, but it's okay. We'll bounce back, right? We got a long time to go. Got a great loaded show for you guys tonight, as we always do. But I do have to ask you, visit colakicks.com. I'm all over the place tonight. Too much coffee. Our opening kick, right? Our rant about player mobility is brought to you by colakicks.com. That is where you can find the latest and the greatest of shoes and sneakers. All you sneakerheads, that's where you need to be. That's where I shop. That's where I buy my sneakers. I bought some threes and some ones from there the other day. We are going to talk coaching carousel here in a little bit, so hold off on those questions as well. That's colakicks.com. Use promo code Brooks, and you'll get $10 off your next purchase of $100 or more. And those guys always, always give you free shipping. And it's overnight shipping too, dude. You buy them sneakers, they show up on your doorstep the very next day. So if you got a big event, don't worry about getting the order in late, because they'll get it to you as fast as possible with next day shipping. Appreciate those guys over at Cola Kicks, as do we appreciate the folks at Thrive Fantasy. Appreciate you guys for being here. Let's get into tonight's show. I'm going to rank my current job openings, right? There's a lot of jobs that are opening up right now in college football. There will probably be more before the season's out, right? Before bowl season ends, I would imagine there's some more vacancies when it comes to the college football landscape. We'll talk a little bit about what this, you know, coaching frenzy or coaching carousel, rather, as you see in the title of the YouTube video. We'll talk to you about how that impacts Georgia's coaching staff, as you would imagine every single year, let alone years when Georgia's competing and looking like they're going to make a run at a national title. Georgia's coaching staff gets picked off every year. It's going to happen again this year. It's just a matter of who and not a matter of when. We'll talk a little bit about that. And we'll open tonight's show with my thoughts on what I'm calling basically how athletic directors and athletic administrations are moving more towards acting and responding towards decisions like NFL general managers. And what do I mean by this? Okay. What I mean by this is, if you've watched the NFL over the last couple of years, you'll notice that when it comes to rookie quarterbacks, right, which is the major investment in college football, I want a CEO of my company. If I have one overall draft pick, I want a great coach that I know can run my program. In the NFL, I want a daggum franchise quarterback, okay? And I can find a decent coach. It's the other way around, right? And in the NFL, at the most important position, at the most important decision, what you're seeing decision makers do is, guys, they give it 3 or 4 years. They give it one contract and they're out. As of the last, I think, 10 NFL draft classes, okay, the last 10, if you're a first-round quarterback, if you're a first-round draft pick at the quarterback position, you have a 50% chance of making it to your second contract with the team that drafted you. Robert Griffin III did not make a second contract with the team that drafted him, right? Number two overall. They traded a litany of picks to go get it. He wasn't even on the roster 3 years later. Kirk Cousins was, the guy they drafted in the third round. Okay, Josh Rosen, 10th overall draft pick, was not on the roster the following year. Okay, so they're giving it a full year, sometimes two, sometimes the full length of the rookie contract, Baker Mayfield, before they make a decision. But by the end of it, by God, they've made a decision, right? They either move on, find another one, move up in the draft and go take another one, take another swing at things, or they re-sign the guy, right? One of two options, okay? And what I mean by this is, like, I think that application and that thought process should probably be taken the same route with head coaches at the college ranks. Look, after 3 or 4 years, I should know whether or not I got a football coach. And I'm here to tell you, if after 3 years, I don't know if I've got a football coach, that's your answer. You don't. Okay, so I think the writing was on the wall with Florida last year, right? They're 3 years in to the Dan Mullen regime at the end of last season. You go 8-4 with the most talented roster that, by the way, folks, he was ever going to have at Florida. I could give him a decade down there. The roster would have gotten worse in terms of talent, right? So the best and most talented football team he had was in 2020, and he goes 8-4. And by the way, the end of that didn't look great. It's the shoe game against a freshman quarterback and half of a roster against LSU last year during a pandemic season. It's, yeah, you played Alabama tight, and then you get boat raced and embarrassed against Oklahoma, and your press conferences all the while, jokes. Jokes. Okay, so the writing was on the wall. After 3 years at Florida, I knew exactly who Dan Mullen was. So why go out and give it a contract extension this offseason? I don't know. Okay, that's a mistake. But what I'm telling you is that the more and more, and you're seeing this process get into college football, guys, there's openings left and right. You get 3 years, 4 years, gone. I know who you are after 3 years of college football as a head coach. Matter of fact, most of the time, I kind of know who you are after two. After two. I think I know pretty clearly that Sam Pittman is going to be a success story at Arkansas. I think we all know that. That one's working. That's a hit. That's 2 years in. There doesn't look like there's going to be any self-destruction after an 8-4 season coming up next year for Arkansas. We know that, right? I think the Josh Heupel hire 1 year in, we think that one's pretty daggum good. Same thing up there at South Carolina with Shane Beamer. Guys, those guys are playing hard for that football coach late into a meaningless football season. Those are checks. Those are checks. Those are buy-in from your players. Mario Cristobal up there at Oregon. It didn't take long before we knew that was a success story. Yeah, he dropped a game this past week. They didn't look great. That program looks good, though. They're recruiting really, really well. They're playing relatively well. God forbid they get another quarterback like they did 2 years ago. And, man, it might look really, really good out there at Oregon, right? So I think these things, and I think this thought process of, hey, give them the first contract life, get out, okay? And we should know midway through whether or not we got a dude. And I think the writing had been on the wall at Florida. And finally, you know, you start losing OT games to Missouri. You start giving up 42 points and a half against Samford. And, yeah, you're going to be fired, especially when there was literally very limited, positive momentum around that program, period. We told you last week, there's no point in denying the inevitable in life. It was inevitable that Dan Mullen would get fired down there in Florida, right? It was inevitable. I think you give them time, right? You give them the 3 years, okay? You let them, unless it's a situation, and here's the deal. And a lot of people are going to throw Jeff Collins at me because I've been one to kind of defend what the Georgia Tech staff's been doing down there. I think that was like a 6-year rebuild at Georgia Tech considering what Paul Johnson was doing. When it comes to how he was recruiting in terms of only recruiting like really fast slot backs to run the triple, quarterbacks that could run, didn't care about throwing, offensive linemen that were undersized and more athletic, right? Receivers that were just big, tall, and could block, basically extensions of tight ends out there. He had to revamp an entire recruiting strategy from the bottom up. It's going to take 3 or 4 years just to recycle that roster. I think it was best. I saw a quote from, I think it was Bill Belichick. He said, you've got to learn how to lose closely before you learn how to win. Right, and that's what Georgia Tech's doing right now. If you watch them, apart from the Notre Dame game, those loss margins, they're getting tighter. Okay, and then the occasional 55-0 or 70-14 in the case of Clemson last year. So, give it 3 or 4 years, move on. Approach it just like a rookie quarterback that you do in the NFL. Right, another one, Mel Tucker. You know that one. Within 18 months, you knew that dude was going to work out there in Michigan State. Mike Leach, you've been paying attention to what they've been doing out there in Mississippi State? You know that one's going to work. Must not be that hard, Dan Mullen, to win out there in Mississippi State for them Bulldogs, right? Mike Leach doing it really, really quickly. By the way, with a system that a lot of people said wouldn't work in the SEC, me being one of those people. I think all of these quick success stories is how it should work. You should show signs of a successful program on the horizon and maintain that into year three. And a large portion of that comes from recruiting. If you recruit really well, you're always going to be relatively good. Okay? Jimmy's and Joe's. We've been telling you about that for a long time here on this network, as has Kirby Smart. Okay? He was 100% right when he said what he said about show me the greatest coach of all time. I'll show you a really good recruiter. He better be able to recruit. It's the facts. Okay? It would be like an NFL general manager looking at you and go, we don't really care if we draft good players because we got good developers and we got a coach that's got great scheme. How silly would that be? How silly would that be, right? That's basically what the motto was down there at Florida. Just give me average guys and my scheme's better than everyone else. That's a bit arrogant on a coaching staff's part right there. So, yeah, you could see why they went on to make the decision that they did when it comes to Dan Mullen. Now, there are a ton of openings in college football right now. As of right now, I see 8 in Power 5. There are 8 Power 5 openings and a couple of non-Power 5s that we're going to talk about that I think could impact Georgia's coaching discussion and Georgia's coaching staff. I'm going to rank them. Okay, 1 through 8, we'll start at number 1. I'll briefly talk through 1 through 4. I'm not going to talk about Washington, TCU, Virginia Tech, and Wazoo. We'll talk about TCU in a little bit, but we're going to break down why I put these guys 1 through 4. Okay, number 1 is LSU. I think LSU is the best job available right now for 2 reasons. Okay, it's an elite recruiting base. Okay, and it's not very hard to convince kids from Louisiana to stay in Louisiana. I think their retention rate is higher than any other state, probably, when it comes to elite athletes. The best of the best in the state of Louisiana play for the Tigers. That's facts. Okay, I can't say the same about Georgia. I can't say the same about Alabama. I damn sure can't say the same thing about Texas, right? But at LSU, I can. The best players in the state of Louisiana play for the LSU Tigers. That's historically facts, okay? So that's number 1. Number 2, they lead the nation in what I call DDWH, which means dum-dums have won there, okay? Ed Orgeron and Les Miles have won a national title at LSU. Let that sink in. Ed Orgeron and Les Miles have won a national title at LSU. You ain't got to be a rocket science, right? Scientist, excuse me. You ain't got to be a genius. You ain't even got to be the world's best coach. You just got to be okay and surround yourself with some pretty good staffers that know what they're doing, right? If you can do those 2 things, you'll survive at LSU. You'll probably win a lot of football games. It's a hard job to mess up. I'm going to tell you that right. Again, DDWH, dum-dums win here. Period. Point blank. So LSU number 1. Number 2 for me, it's not available yet, but it's going to be available. And that's Miami. I would imagine they're going to get rid of Manny Diaz. I would hope that they get rid of Manny Diaz. I would imagine that whatever athletic director takes that job is going to probably clean house of Manny Diaz and get his own guy. Okay? So let's just talk about this conversation as if Miami is available. Okay? I would put them number 2. And a lot of people are going to sit here and say, Brooks, Miami hadn't been relevant. Excuse me. In 20 years, why is Miami on this list so high at number 2? And I'm going to tell you this. This new AD that they've got, okay, they pushed Blake James out because he wasn't prioritizing football. He wasn't spending the copious amounts of money that they have down there, and it is a lot. I think it's top 15 in terms of athletic funding in the country, okay? There's a lot more money down there than you think there is. Miami number 2, they're going to change some things, okay? And I'm here to tell you, with NIL, you've heard me talk about this on this channel before. NIL is nothing but legal cheating to me. Straight up. It's nothing but legal cheating to me. It's the NCAA throwing their hands up and saying, look, we're tired of running down, Ole Miss assistant coaches' phone numbers and burner phones. We're just sick and tired. We're tired of chasing around Jeremy Pruitt and his, defensive line or running backs coach with McDonald's bags full of cash. We're just sick and tired of it. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to throw our hands up. We're going to pass this name, image, and likeness bill, and we're going to let y'all figure it out. Okay, so that's what they did. They just legalized cheating. And I don't know about you guys, but the city of Miami in general, if you know anything about it, they're pretty damn good at cheating. Like, really good. And if you're going to make it legal and allow it to happen out in front, kind of like crypto, well, guess what? The city of Miami is going to become the capital of crypto, right? That's how these things work. So I would put number 2, Miami. Number 3 is Florida. Okay, I put them above USC for a handful of reasons. It's still the SEC, guys, and that means a lot. Okay, it means a lot, especially when we're talking about revenue and TV dollars, right? It means a ton. And if anyone, and I mean any coach in America, can go down there, and it sounds like Billy Napier might be the guy that they're kind of leaning towards right now as we sit here November 22nd on a Monday evening. If you can convince that athletic department that it's important to kind of spend money on recruiting, it's kind of important to, you know, buy in terms of culture, to go about recruiting the sport of football like you're supposed to be competitive with the likes of Alabama and Georgia in the SEC and LSU whenever it gets turned around. And guess what? Texas and Oklahoma are coming too. Jimbo Fisher's recruiting like an animal out there at Texas A&M. You get the point. If you're going to be successful in this conference, you best recruit. So they need more buy-in from their athletic director, okay? It wasn't all on Dan Mullen. Your athletic director did turn your own head coach in for maybe, possibly, not conducting visits properly during the pandemic. Okay? He wasn't the only one. I'm not saying team, but he wasn't the only one, okay? Little bit hasty right there. So when it comes to Florida, I put them three because, A, they don't have the facilities that the rest of these SEC schools have. They don't. If you look at LSU's facilities, Georgia's facilities, Alabama's facilities, their contemporaries in the conference, their facilities outrank Florida's every single time. So until they upgrade that or have a little bit more buy-in from the athletic department, they're three, okay? If you want to recruit like Urban Meyer, you best kind of, you know what I'm saying? They ain't doing that right now at Florida. They're ratting on their own coach, okay? If you want to recruit like Urban Meyer, if you want to recruit like the rest of these guys, especially now with name, image, and likeness, okay? So buy-in from the administration is important out there. Number four, everyone tells me this USC job's great. Everyone tells me this USC job's great. Nobody's jumping at it right now. Nobody. Now, they might be setting up for it behind the scenes, but I don't see anybody jumping out of their current positioning, wherever they're at, to go run out there to USC. And I know everyone wants to throw this NIL thing at me. Everyone wants to say, but Brooks, it's L.A., they have more Fortune 500 companies than Atlanta and the Southeast combined. Look how many companies and potential suitors that you could market yourself with. Yeah, that's fine. But I just told you, it's legal cheating. Who are the players that you hear mentioned with big-time NIL deals? It's Bryce Young in Alabama, right? It's Derek King down there in Miami, right? It's JT Daniels signing with Zaxby's at Georgia, right? It's those guys. It's Derek Stingley signing with Canes out there at LSU, right? What do all of those guys have in common? Every single one of them. They play for programs that have alumnus that live, eat, sleep, and breathe football at that university. And I don't know if you've been to a USC football game anytime lately or even watched them on TV, but they ain't got a whole lot of that buy-in from alumnus right now. They don't. They don't have a whole lot of people live, eat, sleep, dying, breathing Trojan football in 2021. That ain't it. So you can tell me it's the greatest job in the world because you're in LA and you have all the access in the world to NIL money. That's fine. But guess who else does? Alabama's boosters that absolutely die when it comes to the Crimson Tide. Like, they want it on their tombstone. Okay, and that means they're probably willing to pay just a little bit more than you are when it comes to endorsement deals. Ain't no way an Alabama quarterback should be making close to $1 million. And I don't know if he is, but Nick Saban leaked that. And I don't hear nobody leaking any information about, Jackson Dart, who might be the most marketable quarterback in the history of quarterbacks. His dadgum name's Jackson Dart out there at USC. I don't hear no press clippings about him riding around in free cars out there. I don't. Georgia's backup outside backer does, though. You see what I'm saying? So the SEC is still going to care a little bit more about all this. Okay. The Southeastern school is still going to care a little bit more about this, which means they're going to invest a little bit more about this, right? Which means all that advantageous positioning that you have out there at LA, it don't mean much. Don't mean very much, right? So I put USC number four right there. And then 5, 6, 7, and 8, I went Washington, TCU, Virginia Tech, and Wazoo. Now, the main question that I would imagine most Georgia fans have listening to tonight's broadcast is, hey, Brooks, how does all this, all these rankings that you're doing, how does any of this apply to the Georgia Bulldogs? Well, I got you, right? I told you at the very beginning of the show. I mean, think about it. 2017, you had Shane Beamer leave your staff, right? In 18, I'm pretty sure Chaney left for Pruitt's staff up there at Tennessee, right? And I'm missing a couple more in there. 19, you lose Sam Pittman, okay? 20, you lose Charlton Warren. So, and I'm missing guys in this process here. But you've had assistant coach after assistant coach after assistant coach ripped off your staff every year. Every single year. Even in years where you're going 8-2 in an all-SEC schedule, losing to Alabama and Florida. Still having guys getting pulled from your staff. So I'm here to tell you, when you have a year like this year, you're going to have guys pulled from your coaching staff. That's not a matter of when or if, or excuse me, it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when and a matter of who. Okay, so as far as the who goes, let's talk about it for a little bit. Number one, okay, when it comes to you're a Georgia fan, worried about your coaching staff, the number one thing you got to watch and watch closely, okay, and watch closely is the Nick Saban coaching tree, okay? There's three guys right now, Billy Napier, Mario Cristobal, Lane Kiffin. They're the three hottest names in the sport when it comes to coaching and, you know, guys up for these positions, right? Guys up for these open slots at these really big programs. All three of them have Nick Saban backgrounds. And when it comes to Nick Saban coaches, the number one thing that they love to do is poach the staff that they just left, okay? Or poach the staff of somebody that they're, familiar with, right? So guys that mingled in that Saban tree, I'm talking the Glenn Schumanns. I'm talking all those personnel and assistant staffers that you've never heard of, but that mean a whole lot to the program. A bunch of them guys going to get picked. Okay, a bunch of them guys are going to get snatched off your coaching staff, I would imagine. Maybe not a bunch. A bunch is the wrong term. But if it's two or three, okay, two or three of your support staff, that's important. Those are guys that, you know, do a lot of work in and around your building, especially if it's an assistant coach, especially if Billy Napier down there in Florida can convince a guy like Glenn Schumann to come take a DC job, right? Those things will change the directory of your program pretty quickly defensively. Okay, so that's the first thing I'd do. I'd watch that Saban tree. I'd watch those three guys, see where they go, see who they try to pick in terms of coming to join their staff and help them on their, you know, voyage into becoming a head coach at a program like that. Now, the other schools that I would watch very, very closely, particularly when it comes to guys like Dan Lanning and maybe even Todd Monken, okay, the TCUs of the world, Dan Lanning would be an incredible hire for TCU. Now, it's going to be a program like that, guys. It's going to be a mid-major, bottom of the Power 5, you know, smaller Power 5 school like TCU that's going to make a run on Lanning. Schools like Troy. TCU might be a little bit high, okay? But there's a lot of positions to be filled, and there's a lot of coaches that are going to get picked up, and a lot of names are going to get scratched off that list at TCU when it comes to applicants. And then Dan Lanning is going to get a phone call, I would imagine. So things like that, schools like Virginia Tech, Troy, and FIU. I would pay attention to those coaching searches. I would pay attention to who they're trying to interview, who they're putting in requests for. Those are things that I would kind of be worried about, right? And also, by the way, if you didn't learn anything about Sam Pittman leaving your program to go take a head coaching job, guys, they're going to pull people with them. They are. Okay, so when a coach leaves your program to go become a head coach, the first thing he's going to do is hire his buddies that he can possibly pull. It basically becomes the scene from, what is this, Show Me the Money? Jerry Maguire, right? Where he gets up, walks out of the office, and then, what's her name, stands up and goes, I'm coming with you, right? Same scenario type of deal, except the guy leaving sits there and recruits, right? Dale McGee, every single year. Every single year, somebody comes and tries to hire him, and Georgia's got to give him a raise. Is this another one of those years? Or do they finally say, enough's enough? I mean, you are by far, Dale McGee is hands down the highest paid running backs coach in America. I mean, he's not even close. Okay, so is this the year that someone finally pulls him away? Auburn tries to get him every single year, giving him assistant head coaches titles, right, and still letting him do the running back stuff. That's his alma mater. That makes sense. He's from Columbus. He grew, you know, made his way into coaching in Columbus. It's a possibility. Every year someone throws money at him. You got to keep him around somehow, some way. And I think this year of all years is the year where we're about to find out, guys, whether or not Todd Monken has aspirations to become a head coach again. That's why, I mean, he's been a head coach one time and is at Southern Miss for two seasons. And he was out to the NFL, OC. Wide receivers coach, I believe, at Tampa. Anyways, so we're about to find out. Somebody's going to call Todd Monken and offer him a job, I would imagine. He's done some really incredible things considering what he's had going on this year in terms of injuries, quarterback availability, nonsense, drama, all kinds of stuff, okay? So, yeah, somebody's probably going to try. You're going to find out pretty quickly. The only thing about Monk, he's 55 years old, and I'm not saying that's too old to become a head coach. It's not. But it's old enough to make you realize or make you think, like, dang, dude, I make $1.8 million a year after bonuses here at the University of Georgia. I don't really have to recruit, okay? I kind of just talk football with prospects, tell them what I want to do with them in terms of how I want to use them, and then I just get out. I wear the G around. Kirby Smart delivers me the best players. I'm always going to have, you know, decent to above average quarterback play. I'm always going to have big hog mollies up front. I'm always going to have weapons on the outside. My job's pretty easy. Now, granted, I have to deal with somebody who most people would call a little over-controlling, a little overbearing. Most great people and most smart people are a little overbearing and a little micromanage-y. So is he getting to the point where in his life where maybe almost $2 million and a cake job is good enough for him? Todd Hartley, that's getting in the comments right now. You see what that dude's doing out on the recruiting trail right now. You tell me a smaller school might not give him an opportunity to be an OC. Maybe that's something he wants to do. That's the other thing you got to remember about these coaches. They're all humans, which means maybe some of them have a little bit more self-awareness than the others. Maybe some of them know that maybe I am just cut out to be an OC the rest of my life and make really good money, okay, and not have to worry about all the management of an entire organization. Maybe that's a realization point that Monk is coming to. Maybe Todd Hartley realizes, hey, it's about time to make a run at being an OC if I want to be one, right? That's where you're kind of getting when it comes to your coaching staff. And honestly, what happens to Todd Monken will determine what happens to Buster Faulkner, okay? Your quarterback's coach. Guys, pay attention on Saturdays. There's one guy in a visor that looks like Kirby Smart's younger brother that stands next to your quarterbacks every single time they come to the sideline. You know who it is? It's Buster Faulkner. And you know who's got a lot of, like, juice and momentum as a young football coach in the ranks? Buster Faulkner. So I promise you, I shouldn't say promise you, but I can almost guarantee you that if Todd Monken sticks around at the University of Georgia this year, somebody's going to sniff around Buster Faulkner. Someone's going to do it. And it might be one of these coaches that leaves your staff, right? If it happens. If Dan Lanning gets a head coaching job, why wouldn't he call Buster Faulkner and say, hey, come be my OC? I know you've been an OC at Southern Miss. Why not come be an OC for me at TCU or whatever it is, right? I think those are all reasonable options for this coaching staff. And here's the deal. We've talked about this a bunch. None of this, I mean, it matters, but it shouldn't worry you or concern you for the future of your program in terms of success rate under Kirby Smart, because the one thing that I think he's done better than anything else, apart from recruiting, right? This includes recruiting. He's recruited exceptionally well. He's restaffed his coaching staff better than I ever expected him to do. It's a really, really hard thing to do. And guess what? It's kind of been the downfall right now of Alabama. Alabama has the two worst coordinators I think they've had in a long time right now. Bill O'Brien, kind of just a shell of an old Sarkisian offense, right? And their defensive coordinator, Google him and check him out on Twitter. Ain't too many people happy with that one either. Okay, so this ability to restack a staff and hire quality people and get them in and replace quality people that have left your program is vital. And Kirby Smart's shown the ability to do that. I mean, what he did with Matt Luke, flipping that over in 48 hours, hands down. Hands down, one of the best coaching flips I've seen, period. He had no offensive line coach December 8th, after the SEC championship game against LSU. Sam Pittman takes the Arkansas job. 48 hours later, on a Wednesday morning, Matt Luke's in Athens as the offensive line coach. Thursday, he's in Darlington, Rome, Georgia, finalizing Tate Ratledge. That December 15th or whatever, he was out there in New Orleans finalizing the deal with Cedric Van Pran Granger. That February, he locks up Broderick Jones. I mean, good God, just immediately flip it around. And I would imagine he's already got a long list of guys that he knows he might want to work with. You think Jamal Adai was a name that just popped up last year? No. Okay, that's a Southeast Georgia guy. That's a guy that got his start in college coaching at Van Osta State. You know who else did? Kirby Smart. Yeah, pretty entwined, right? The guy knows who he's getting next before he even knows he's got to go get him. That's how smart people do it. 35 minutes in, man. We rolled through tonight's show. Yeah, man. We're going to call it a night tonight. I would do Q&A normally, but I'm going to go watch some Monday Night Football. Take some notes on the Manning cast, whatever. We'll see you guys. Appreciate y'all for being here. See you next time.